15 Chapter 9. I was laying on the ground, moaning in pain, my body beaten black and blue. I spat out a glob of blood, before wiping more off the liquid from under my nose. I had fought as hard as I could, used every trick in the book, and still got my ass absolutely handed to me. Before you ask, no, I wasn't caught in some clusterfuck adventure again. No, this was worse. Well, my lord, Lady Mage Mormont boomed out with a massive smile. It seems there is one bear you just can't tame. Everyone in the training yard laughed uproariously, Howland and Stannis the loudest of them all. Damn traitors. We had traveled to Bear Island from Last Hearth, deciding to visit the home of the Mormonts before traveling to the Wall. After all, it was easier to take a ship to Bear Island from Last Hearth than it was to try and take a ship from the Shadow Tower. Our stay with the Umbers had been relatively pleasant, with myself spending most of my time recovering my escapades with snarks and wildlings. Part of me wondered if it wasn't some weird backlash from making my new armor. As if the snark was attracted to the scent of magic. Maybe there was more to the saying, a sword without a hilt, than I thought. I had only managed to speak with Ayla a few times, the girl blushing and stuttering in my presence before finding an excuse to be elsewhere. Apparently giving a kiss to a random boastful Tarzan who was about to die is a different kettle of fish than actually kissing Brandon Stark. A massive shy streak showed itself in Lady Ayla, and the Greek John took massive pleasure in ribbing me about it constantly. I was still unsure if I would agree to a betrothal with the girl. I may have liked her, but one action-packed day on the run and suffering from fever is not the best way to get to know someone. I was still only 14, so I had about 2 years to decide before my father would probably decide for me. We had arrived at Bear Island without any further issues, and as I expected, Mage Mormont immediately challenged me to a spar in the yard. Not wanting to disrespect her by turning it down, she would think it's because she is a woman, but truthfully she terrifies me. I gave into her request. I fought valiantly against my mighty foe, but her mace proved to be stronger than my blunted sword and her experience triumphed over my athleticism and skill. Lady Mage put a hand out for me, and grabbed it gratefully as she helped pull me to my feet. You are without a doubt, one of the greatest warriors I have ever fought, my lady. I told her with a wince, dabbing at a small cut on my eyebrow. Ha, we have to be my lord, with the Ironborn and wildlings, we women are in more danger than the men. So we had to become tougher than them too. She laughed boisterously, the Mormont women all cheering with her. Now come, Lord Brandon, we shall feast tonight. When I first awoke in this world, I had so many dreams of things I would try and introduce. Amazing inventions to pull this backwater world into resembling a fictional society. I had dreams of northern muskets, great railroads from the neck to the wall, and steamships sailing into every port of the world. Reality bitch slapped those dreams like a two-copper whore. I settled for doing what I could, revolutionizing steel, sailing, farming, and medicine, forever immortalizing my name in the history books. I had invented new drinks, brought new wealth and prosperity, and had done more in my short life than the vast majority of Starks before me. If there was one thing I never expected to introduce to Westeros, it was this. We were in the Great Hall of the Bear Keep, standing by a table. Howland and I were one side while Mage and Jorah Mormont were on the other. Sitting on the table were 10 wooden cups, set up in a pyramid on either side. Each cup was filled halfway with ale, Howland and I both holding a piece of wood that had been carved and sanded in the shape of a ping pong ball. I had invented beer pong, and it was glorious. Howland turned out to be a crack shot, and we had been winning every game we played. This was the fourth round of the night, and the first time we were up against Lady Mage. The game was long and hard, and while it came down to one cup apiece, it was Lord Jorah that sunk the winning shot. I drained the cup, before going over and throwing an arm around Jorah's shoulder. Good game, Jorah, damn good game. I told him, giving him a pat on the back. We will have a spar in the morning, see if I can't regain my lost honor. I look forward to it, Brandon. Jorah answered with a smile. I walked over to the front of the room, where Yogi was sitting by the high table. The massive bear had been treated like royalty since the moment we set foot on Bear Island, and I was honestly worried that he wouldn't want to leave. Unlike most of the castles of the north we had stayed at, Yogi was given his own room in Bear Keep. It was larger than my room in the keep and covered in new deer pelts. He had a basket of fresh fish every morning, A barrel of ale was kept open and full for whenever he was thirsty, and the guards even bowed to him as he walked past. The bear was soaking in the attention like a sponge soaks up water. He strutted around the island with his held high, nodding magnanimously every time someone bowed to him. "You know, Yogi, I honestly never thought I would get bored with drinking. I mean, it seems like all we do half the time. Maybe I do have a problem," I said, looking at my cup of ale suspiciously. Yogi huffed, shaking his head, before grabbing his own tankard, which was actually a small barrel, with two hands, and taking a long drink. "Yeah, well, I don't have a bear's constitution. Our drinking contests have proved that," I responded. The bear gave me a smug smile, patting me on the shoulder gently with a paw. It still almost knocked me off my chair. "Laugh it up, big guy, you better enjoy it. You're not going to get a chance to party like this after we head to the wall," I told him, returning his smugness with my own. Yogi whined, before giving me a big puppy dog look. I got the scene of him arriving to rescue me from the wildlings after I passed out, a flash of the wall, as imagined by a bear, and a sense of worry. "I'm sorry I worried you, big guy, but I'm not changing my plans just because of a snark." Yogi just snorted. The bear was probably the only person that believed me about the snark, and that was only because I showed him the memories. Even then, he still seemed skeptical. "We've been over this, buddy. This is something I really think we gotta do," I said, standing back up. "Now, I am going to bed. You coming?" My oldest friend waved me off, picking his barrel back up to take a drink. I shook my head, before heading out of the room. On the way out, I ran into Stannis, who was standing outside the door of my room. "What's up, Stan?" I asked him. "You are planning something, when we go to the wall," he said simply. "So what if I am? I know you, Bran. The only thing you could be planning to do at the wall, that you wouldn't want people to know about, is if you were going to go north of it. If you think I will be staying behind, you are mistaken." Stannis nodded once, turned on his heel, and marched off to his room without giving me a chance to respond. Cheeky little shit. The next morning I woke up stretching and groaning, my mouth dry from the alcohol but without a hangover. I put on my clothes before walking out into the hallway. I was heading to the Great Hall, having just passed the ruins of the Mormonts themselves. I heard a door open behind me, spinning around to see who it was, and my mouth dropped open. Returning my wide-eyed stare with an identical one of his own, was Yogi. Walking out of Lady Mage Mormont's room. In the early morning, I turned around, and kept walking to the hall, pretending I didn't see anything. I was way too sober for this shit. Lyanna Stark had managed to ditch her guards, and was currently running through the streets of Wintertown. While her mother told her it was once practically a ghost town, only full of people during winter, Lyanna didn't believe her. Wintertown was always bursting with life. People were bustling around the markets selling their wares, and the massive horses were pulling carts all over the place. She even saw unicorns. Lyanna loved exploring all over Winterfell and its surrounding town. She was always bursting with energy and always had to keep moving. She hated doing needlework and learning her ladylike manners from her mother, but Mama had told her that if she learned it all, when she was a bit bigger she would find someone to teach her the sword. Father didn't like that idea, and tried to argue with Mother about it, saying that it wasn't proper behavior for a lady, but Mother just laughed at him. Mother just told Father to go say that on Bear Island, and Father got real quiet after that. "Hello, my little wolf, what are you doing out here?" Lyanna jumped up in the air, spinning around to see her mother smiling at her. Lyanna smiled back, gladly leaping into her mother's embrace. "Come on, my dear little wolf, let's get you into the bath before dinner," her mother said, carrying her back into the castle. It was later in the evening, and Lyanna was sitting at the high table with her parents eating supper. The food was a rich and exotic affair, a random expense her mother decided on due to a craving. It was slow roasted boar, stuffed with Dornish peppers and a sweet yellow fruit called pineapple from the Summer Islands, and had been drizzled with Whitehill mead the entire time it was cooked. Lyanna didn't know all of this, however, and was instead drinking lots of water to cool down her burning mouth. As she finished her drink, she heard her father telling her mother about the latest letter from older brother Brandon. She always loved when his letters came, as they were usually full of amazing adventures. "What did Bran say?" she asked her father excitedly. Apparently he fought a snark, and saved Morse Umber's daughter from wildlings. Her father said, smiling warmly at her. Whoa, really? Lyanna asked, both awed and scared. Brandon must be really brave to have fought a snark, she thought, as Nan had told her the legend of the snark and it was really scary. Oh, don't worry, Lyanna, he didn't actually fight a snark. Brandon is just saying that because he is too embarrassed to admit that he was drunk, got lost, and fell in a river. Honestly, that boy really needs to stop this drinking habit of his. I will be having strong words with him when I see him. Her mother said darkly, stabbing her pork with her knife. Leave the boy alone, Lara, he has more than earned the right to let loose every now and again. Father said, waving his hand dismissively. Well, Lyanna didn't care what they thought. Her big brother killed a snark, and she couldn't wait to tell all of the town's kids about it. Lyanna snuck out of the hall as her parents bickered, and ran out of the keep, smiling the whole time. Eddard Stark held his bastard sword with two hands, waiting for his opponent to strike. Eddard, or Ned as most people called him, was locked in yet another spar with his good friend Robert. Ned had first latched onto Robert for a simple reason: he reminded him of Brandon in a lot of ways. While Robert wasn't as smart, and tended to say some rather impolite things without thinking, they both had a lot in common. For one, both boys were absolute monsters in the training yard, and tended to knock Ned around more times than he won. They had both enjoyed crude jokes and both of them had a tendency of drinking too much. All in all, for a young boy in a basically new world, Robert had been a small slice of home. Ned dodged to the left as Robert swung his hammer, stepping into the swing and swiping his sword at his friend's unprotected back. Robert bent with the blow just right, sending his sword skipping off his armor, before nailing Ned in the stomach with a light uppercut with his hammer. You do a good job dodging, Ned, but you don't commit enough to your swing. You're too used to your opponent dodging or deflecting, and pummeling him with your follow-up. When you fight someone like me, you gotta make every swing count, because I can eat those pussy strikes for breakfast. His best friend explained to him. Robert may be only a year older than Ned, but he had an instinctual grasp on combat that few could match. Ned always wondered who would win a fight, Robert or Brandon. Robert was younger, but nearly the same size, and while Brandon had more technical skill and experience, Robert was just pure raw talent. Well done, Robert, and you as well, Ned. While you may have lost, there is no dishonor in an honest defeat against a better opponent. Take his lessons to heart, as I agree with them. You have the ability to be a great warrior, but that is what this training is for. So that you may see your failures, and rise to your successes. Lord John Arryn said, giving them both a smile from he stood by the edge of the yard. I receive a letter from your brother Lord Brandon, Ned. It appears he was attacked by a snark on the road, and was thrown into a river after killing it. From there he stumbled upon Lord Morsumber's daughter who was being chased by wildlings, and rescued her. Lord Arryn said, mirth flowing out of his voice. Ned and Robert shared a glance, before bursting into laughter. Well, that is one way of saying you were drunk and fell in a river. Ned japed, wiping his eyes. Definitely sounds better. Gods, I wish we were there with them, Ned. Stannis is having all the adventures, and we are stuck here in an empty mountain being forced to learn Valyrian from a stuffy old maester. Robert boomed, almost knocking Ned over with a pat on the back. We are learning what we need to be lords, Robert, plus Lord John's hospitality is more than satisfactory. Ned stated diplomatically, glancing at Lord Arryn. Don't worry, Ned, I am sure their adventures seem much more exciting. Lord John chuckled, clearly unoffended. 7. I still can't believe what his last letter said about Stannis. That little prick was always a dour old man stuck in a toddler's body, harping on about honorable behavior and doing your duty. I never thought he'd have the balls to shoot a man down like a rabid hound. Robert mused, shaking his head disbelievingly. Well, I can definitely confirm that one, as Lord Rickard got the report from Lord Dustin. John said, putting a hand on one of each of their shoulders. Now, it is time for you two to go to your language lessons. Both of them groaned, but neither one protested as they were led to the maester's quarters. The wall was a majestic sight. Have you ever seen one of those things that just makes you stand in awe? Really understand just how small you are in the universe. I had cockily thought that I was already one of the greatest Starks. That I had made a legacy that would echo through history, and maybe I did. Looking at this massive construct of ice, nearly touching the clouds themselves, and stretching far off into the distance in either direction, I felt inadequate. Bran the Builder raised this thing without any special knowledge, no advanced science, just ingenuity, magic, and muscle power. I could feel the magic rolling off of it from here over a mile away, the sensation making my hair stand up on end. He built this thing before steel was even invented. Castle Black, fully repaired, honestly looked like the intimidating center of the Night's Watch. Large stone walls, held together with concrete, lined the three sides in front of the massive piece of ice. There were large, ironwood gates, and a portcullis made of solid Stark steel. The buildings and towers had all been rebuilt, and I could see the Lord Commander Corgyle waiting at the gates. "Lord Stark, it is an honor to have you here at Castle Black. Please, allow my steward to show you the way to where you will be staying, and some of the boys can take your horses to the stables. I take it the bear will be staying in your room," the Lord Commander stated, looking at me. I just gave him a nod as an answer. "It is an honor to be here, Lord Commander. House Stark has long been a supporter of the Night's Watch, and I am glad to see your halls looking so newly repaired," I responded magnanimously. "We shall be having a small feast to celebrate your arrival in a few hours' time. A steward will be sent to fetch you then," Corgyle told me simply, motioning to his men to follow his orders. It was late that night, and everyone was asleep. While there were usually guardsmen watching the tunnel we were in front of, Howland had managed to sneak a sedative in their ale. I was currently strapping on Yogi's new armor as we prepared to head out. I had taken Yogi's measurements a while ago, and sent them to Winterfell. They had sent me an amazing set of plate armor for the bear, and my friend looked absolutely terrifying with it on. I had only managed to put some basic enchantments on it, for strength, protection, and comfort, but making the entire set myself would have taken months. Once Yogi was armored up, I put on Tornado's saddle, and waited for the rest of the men that would be coming with me beyond the wall. Howland Reed came trotting up first, riding on his own horse, wearing a fur-lined set of new plate armor and carrying his trident. Stannis and Bennard made up the final two members of the group, both of them armed and armored as well. I was wearing the enchanted armor I had forged at Deepwood, and even without any fur lining I was pleasantly warm, the comfort runes I had inscribed working perfectly. I walked into the tunnel, pulling the large door open, clearing the way forward. "All right, I am not going to lie. This is honestly going to be the stupidest thing I have ever done, and probably the most dangerous. Once we leave this tunnel, everything changes. Our names won't mean shit and the people will be more likely to kill us for our armor and weapons than be scared of them. In the lands beyond the wall, honor is nothing more than Southron frippery. This is your last chance to back out, because there will be no turning around once we are out there," I said seriously, looking them each in the eye. To their credit, not one backed down. They squared their shoulders, and met my gaze evenly. "Well, are we just going to wait around, or are we going somewhere?" Howland asked sarcastically. "Let's go then," I said, hopping onto my horse's saddle, and leading the way through the tunnel. We made it out the other side, wide open land in front of us. We could see the haunted forest ahead of us, the wide open and untamed lands of beyond the wall. A land of legends and monsters, magic and terror. "For the mammoths and giants," I whispered to myself. I had decided to go to Craster's Keep for a simple reason. The bastard was helping the others in the show. No way was I going to let an incestuous White Walker factory operate if I could help it. If I remember the fucker's story right, his first wife died giving birth to his first daughter, who was then raised to be his first daughter wife. In the modern world, the government would have stopped at nothing to take him down. Here, they made a deal for a convenient place to rest and not only looked the other way, but actively gave him supplies and nominal protection. Well, I was gonna stop him before he really got anywhere. Howland was scouting the area through Proudwing's eyes, making sure there would be no surprises. We waited for him to come back to himself, before he nodded at us. Craster's Keep was really just a longhouse surrounded by a short and stout wooden wall, with a small gate. Charging forward, Yogi shattered the gate like pottery. Craster came bursting out of his house, a rusted steel sword in his hand, and he stopped short when he saw Yogi's armored form. The bear roared in his face, causing Craster to immediately drop his weapon. I didn't waste any time talking, and I never gave him a chance to defend himself. Stepping forward, I cut his head off with a negligible swipe of my sword. "Good riddance, father," a young voice wailed out, a 10-year-old girl charging out of the house. She screamed when she saw the body, and tried to run back in the house when I grabbed her. I scooped her up like I was carrying my little sister, and walked out of the keep. Behind me, Yogi started pushing the walls and structures over, as Howland and Stannis threw torches on everything, setting it ablaze. I nodded to Bennard as I went by, as he was standing vigilantly outside of the gates making sure we weren't surprised. "No, no, 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 let me go, let me go," the girl kept screaming in my ear, in the harsh dialect of the old tongue. She kicked and scratched, but nothing she did got through my armor. I just kept walking as Craster's recently built keep burned behind me. We had been traveling north for a good 2 weeks now, the girl fighting us the entire way. I don't know if Craster had been a good father before he went incest pedophile, but the girl obviously cared for him as she refused to speak a word after that night. She constantly tried to escape, and while normally I would gladly let her, I knew she wouldn't survive a week alone. She would either be stolen and raped by someone, simply die in the wilderness, or be eaten by cannibals. While I felt absolutely no guilt in killing Craster, I wasn't going to let this girl die for it. I have no idea what I would do with her later, but I would figure it out when the time came. We had been making good time through the haunted forest, Proudwing and Yogi alerting us to any danger before it could hit us. The problem was that I didn't really know where we were going. I knew the giants often interacted with the Thens, so that was our best bet of finding them. I just didn't know what to expect from the Thens. If they were the ones from the books, then they would have a Magnar and generally be open to gifts in exchange for information. If I was dealing with the show Thens, then they would probably just kill us, eat us, and take our gifts anyway. So we would have to be careful about how they were approached. "My lord, there is another group of wildlings about 2 miles north. If we want to go around them, we will have to go east for a while before looping back north," Howland told us, sitting back up in his saddle as he came back to his own body. "Nothing for it then," I sighed, knowing we couldn't deal with any big group. "It'll just take a little longer. Anything interesting about this group? No bone armor this time, I hope." I had been rather worried when Howland told me about one of the wildling groups he had seen around the forest while scouting. A group of warriors wearing armor made of human bones, with a fierce-looking man in charge. Rattleshirt was probably the last person I wanted to meet on this trip, and I was glad we managed to avoid him. "No, my lord. Seemed like an average group of wildlings. The only thing special about them was the man who led them. Great big bear of a man with red hair, reminded a lot of the Greetjon," Howland said, grinning. I stopped in my tracks, and looked at the girl who bound and laid across the back of my horse. I looked back at my companions, before deciding. "You know what? I think I want to meet these wildlings." We came out into the clearing where the wildlings had pitched their tents, the free folk who were milling around all stopping to stare at us. Leaving the three other men behind, Yogi and I started forward. None of them said a word, so we stopped just outside of their camp, and I got off my horse. "I come in peace. I wish to speak with your chief, and I have brought bread and salt," I said in the old tongue, pulling the bread and package of salt out of the saddle bag. "And who are you?" a voice boomed out. Tormund Giantsbane was a monster of a man. Closer to Yogi's size than mine, I could almost believe he could take down a giant. He stood 7 feet tall, with deep red hair, and tree trunk-sized arms. "I am Magnar Brandon, of the House Stark. I come with gifts in exchange for information, and possibly a favor. Who am I speaking with?" I stepped forward, holding out the bag with bread and salt. "I am Tormund, Tormund Giantsbane. I am chief of this tribe." He stepped up next to me, before taking the bag I had offered. He pulled out a piece of hard bread covered in salt, before eating it one bite. "I will see your gifts, and then maybe, I will answer your questions. Come, we shall speak in my tent." "Of course, Chief Tormund. Lead the way." I followed after him, Yogi staying at my side. "You're a warg, are ya?" Tormund eyed me shrewdly. "What gave it away?" I snorted. my good looks, or the fucking huge bear in steel plate. Ha, you got a point there. Only have one warg in me own tribe, but he just has himself a normal wolf, not a beast like that one. Tormund laughed boisterously. We entered his tent, Tormund taking a seat at the end of it. It was a very large tent, more of a pavilion, and I was honestly rather impressed with it. There were a great many different furs and pelts all covering rough wooden furniture, and his bed was just a pile of furs set on the ground. I've slept in worse places. So, what gifts do you have, and what do you want to know? Tormund asked, cutting to the chase as I sat down as well. It is simple, I wish to know where the giants are. On top of that, I want you to take the girl off my hands. Her father was a cunt who planned to impregnate her for more daughters, and then marry the daughters again, all in an endless fucked up line. Any son he had would be left out to freeze and die. So I took his head. The girl doesn't understand though, and if I let her run off on her own, she's as good as dead. As far as gifts, I have this. I told him, placing a small pouch on the table. You do realize she will just end up stolen by one of my men, right? And what in the hells is this thing? He pulled out a small wooden box, with a hinge on the lid, opening it up. It's a compass. That needle in there will always point north, no matter what. With it, you can travel through storms and on starless nights, and still know exactly where you're going. And I know, but it's still better than death or being stolen by one of Rattleshirt's men. I told him, smiling wryly. Tormund looked at the compass with renewed interest, picking it up and moving it around. He shook it roughly a few times, testing its durability, before dropping it on the table. The bulky compass held strong, still working perfectly. Tis a good gift. I will take the girl off your hands, my men could always use new wives and mothers. As far as the giants go, well, it seems fortune smiles on you. Normally the giants are incredibly hard to find, only the Thens keep in contact with them. And they'd more likely gut ya and steal your stuff than accept a gift from a southerner. For some reason, most of the giant tribes have all been grouping together about a 2 weeks walk away from here. Head south and east, away from the Fist. You'll find most of the tribes grouped together outside the caves around there. So, the giants were with Bloodraven, huh? You know, I began, deciding to try my luck. I am the heir of the north, and future lord of Winterfell. If you were willing, I could bring you and your people south, give you lands of your own. You would answer to no one but me. Ha! Tormund slapped his hand on the table with mirth. It sounds great, don't get me wrong lad, but me men would never go for it. I would be chased out of the tribe for even suggesting it. While I would love to see my people, safe and happy in a warm land, our pride is all we have up here. You won't find a man willing to let it go, even for the lands of the south. Ah well, I smiled back. Can't blame me for trying. When the others come you'll wish you accepted, and when that time comes the offer will be open. We had traveled back south, getting to the Fist of the First Men within a few days. It was nothing more than a steep hill in the vague shape of a fist covered in old rubble, but I could still feel a tingle of power coming from it. This had a bastion of strength for the First Men in the years before the dawn, and the land could still remember it. Traveling southeast, we continued to take care to avoid any groups of wildlings. Howland and I took turns warging into Proudwing so that we could always have eyes in the sky. Stannis and Bennard kept a vigilant watch around us, while Yogi kept his nose in the air to be warned of new scents. We had to meander our way around, constantly avoiding different tribes, but we managed to escape detection. Most wargs north of the wall kept predatory companions much like my own friend Yogi. Birds may be great for scouting, but not so much for fighting. In a culture like that of the free folk, the scouting potential of birds is largely ignored. We came up to the caves where I knew Bloodraven was kept, and the area looked exactly as it was shown in the TV show. A wild old forest, deep dark caves, and snow covering everything. Camped around the area were about 2,000 giants. They stood about 15 feet high on average, and were about as wide as most men are tall. They had shaggy white hair covering their bodies, and most of them wore animal skin loin cloths as their only clothing. Mixed in amongst the camp were hundreds of mammoths. I heard a quiet gasp, and looked over to see Stannis and Bennard both staring in awe. While they both willingly came along for this adventure without making any complaints, they never really believed that giants were real. They grumbled about snarks and giants whenever they thought I wasn't listening. Well, look who was right all along, you bastards. I led the way forward, Yogi keeping step with me, and the giants all parted out of the way as we passed. As we got to the mouth of the cave, I looked at my companions. Yogi and I will be going in alone. You three stay here. Without giving them a chance to respond, I walked into the cave, Yogi following after me. The cave was eerie, and with roots growing all over the place and the torchlight flickering from a small breeze. We continued going deeper in, twisting and turning with the tunnel. We must have walked for close to half an hour, when we finally reached our destination. In a large opening, at the opposite end of the tunnel we were in, was Brendan Bloodraven. His old body was tangled up in the many weirwood roots, some of them entering his limbs and keeping him alive. There was a group of about 6 children of the forest standing in the room as well. They were small with dark brown skin and large bulbous eyes. Vines and leaves covered them like clothing, and yet still seemed to be growing even while worn on their bodies. "You have come, Brandon the Clever. As I have seen," Brendan said, his voice a harsh whisper. "I have, but while you may have seen it, I have not. Tell me, why am I here? I came for the giants, not to have my palm read," I said sarcastically. Rivers was a character I was always incredibly wary of. He talked a big talk of being a good guy in the show, trying to help humanity win, but he let things go to hell in a handbasket without batting an eye. "I knew you would come for the giants, and that is why they are here. Tell me, do you truly think the giants would have listened to you? That you were the first Stark to think to gain their allegiance?" "You are a fool," Rivers spat. "I know not why the old gods sent you here, and I do not care. You ruined my work, the song I had woven since I first killed my kin. I would have left you to wander these lands if it was up to me. No, it is the children that have aided you. Wait, I am chosen by the old gods. The hell does that mean?" I asked. "What do you think, you fool? I have seen you, the world you came from. The old gods see past and future as if all is present. They had no wish to see the North brought so low. So they brought you here, and now I know nothing of what will happen." "Makes sense. You did a shitty ass job of fixing things," I said bluntly. "I managed to create the first democracy Westeros has ever seen, if you recall." Rivers shot back. "Yes, with yourself manipulated to be in charge. I see you had such noble intentions," I growled. "It matters not. Brandon the Broken shall never fall from a broken tower, if he is ever born at all. You have changed everything, forever. Go now, Brandon the Clever. Take your giants and mammoths, and prepare. Prepare for war and the long night. I can tell you not what shall happen from here, my sight is more clouded than ever. But take note, you must work to change the future, as quickly as possible. Forget what was, and forge what is, or all will fall to ruin." With that ominous note, the branches started moving, pulling Bloodraven in until he vanished from sight. I let out a shaky breath, and ran my fingers through my hair. "Most of our people shall stay here. We shall watch with the three-eyed raven, for when the enemy comes. We still have some young, those who still dream of rebuilding our people, we would ask you to take them with you. Honor the pact, as your ancestor the builder once did. Give hearth and heart and aid to our people, and we shall do the same to you," the eldest child said as he stepped forward. "I shall," I nodded. "There is an old tower in the Wolfswood that belongs to House Stark. I shall have it rebuilt into a new castle, one that can hold both giant and children. Any of your people will be welcome there." I held out a hand to shake and the elder Greenseer returned it. "I wish you good fortune in the battles ahead. You will need it. The old gods chose you to save the first men and the giants. And even as children, do not fail," he told me. We arrived back at Castle Black close to 2 months after we left. I had accomplished everything I had set out to do and more, and I was incredibly happy. Over 2,000 giants would be coming to the north, and hundreds of mammoths. With the help of the mammoths, I could start working on the Northern Road Network, and actually see it done before my death. The mammoths would have a tough time getting through the wall, due to their massive size, and I honestly didn't really plan to bring them all through Castle Black. I would have some barges made by Eastwatch and ferry them all across the wall from there. I rode at the front of the massive group, Howland and Stannis on either side, Yogi and Bennard flanking them. Behind us were all of the giants and mammoths, with a close to 200 of the children of the forest riding on the backs of the mammoths. I could see the gate of Castle Black open up, and a group of riders came galloping out. In the group was Lord Commander Corgyle along with the captain of my guard that I had left behind, and leading the group was my own father. He was seated high on his horse, wearing a new set of Stark steel plate armor, and he had eyes strapped to his back. My father stared at the giants and mammoths in awe, his jaw hanging open. He finally snapped it shut, took a deep breath, before turning a furious glare at myself. "You, my son, have much explaining to do. End."